I'm Daniel Schwartzman, director of the Seeking Alpha Marketplace. We're continuing our roundtable series with marketplace authors about the coronavirus market. Today I'm speaking with Ruud Heeg, author of Global Deep Value Stocks, which offers high returns on value stocks from seven quantitative strategies backed with research. Ruud, good morning. How are you?
Good morning. Fine. How are you?
I'm good. It's good to talk with you today. So just before, we're going to go into a lot of quantitative stuff, a lot of strategies that you run, but what's the context of how you approach the market today? Obviously, we've had a big sell-off in February and March. We've rebounded to almost start of year levels loosely. So what's your outlook for the market as a whole before we get into the details of your strategies?
Right. I'm very pessimistic because of the lockdowns and because of massive overvaluations still. I expect restrictions to be lifted soon. I think politicians have recognized this mistake. But in the meantime, much damage has already been done, and lots of people and companies will go bankrupt because of this. And eventually, that will have a big effect on the stock market. I'm surprised we haven't seen this already. But I think the coronavirus will have a much smaller impact on the very cheapest stocks globally, more on the high flyers. Yeah.
Okay, so that takes us to, given that outlook, I mentioned in the elevator pitch for your service that you have seven different strategies. We were talking by email before this. What's a strategy you're focused on currently, given that outlook, or what are you looking at right now?
Right. Well, normally I focus on net nets and companies with market caps below $25 million. And I think that is still a good focus today. But I use research, right, from others to for my new service. And in times of high volatility, I also pay extra attention to so-called falling knives. And falling knives are stocks that have gone down with at least 60% during the last 12 months. And I think Brandes Investments, they did some research about this strategy. And their publication, I think, mentions such stocks have even better returns when they originate from times with high market volatility. So the stocks that went down much, that became falling knives in March and still are, they should do much better even than normal falling knives.
Okay, that's it. Speaking quickly with the market caps under $25 million.
Yeah.
One of the things we've seen is larger companies have bigger balance sheets. The market seems to be, we've seen a little bit of a change this week, but the market has generally been favoring larger companies. Mm-hmm. And small business seems to be an area that would be most affected by what's going on. Do you worry about that at all with the nature of the lockdowns and everything else, or you feel that because they're net nets, they still have the balance sheet and they should be fine to make it through?
Right. That's one thing. If the discount is large enough, then it should be okay, provided if the cash is there and the management doesn't steal too much, whatever, right? I avoid companies with too much debt. I think that it's important to avoid these companies in this time. We've already seen it with Hertz and certain airlines. And I think in this time, it's more difficult to refinance debt. And also in normal time, companies can outgrow their financial problems by generating profits. Now that's more, it's going to be more difficult, right? So one of my focus is also companies with strong balance sheets. And by the way, another focus is the beaten down sectors.
Yeah. So what are examples, any examples of either the strong balance sheet or the falling knife or the beaten down sectors that you're looking at closely?
Yeah, yeah. Well, there are all those companies, there are not one is the same. They are all very different. And I can give you, I have prepared six examples of falling knives, net nets, and nanocaps that I recently looked at, and I find them interesting. And if you please, are okay with that,
please.
Well, an interesting falling knife is the German company Hemato. I think you pronounce it as Hemato. They are traded on the Xetra, and their ticker is HAE. And they import and produce generic drugs. So that is a company that you might expect this crisis might be good for them, right? But apparently not. At the moment, they sell, for instance, drugs for heart disease, and they in Germany they keep the hospitals empty also for this group of patients with heart disease. They are not extremely cheap, but a small margin improvement can make the company very profitable. And until recently, this company paid fat dividends. And now they have suspended it. Those high yield investors, they sold. So yeah, it's a good stock for deep value investors. But you don't know, right? It's with these small companies, especially the companies with market caps of 10, 15 million US dollar, it's often the outliers, and by buying many small positions in these stocks, you prevent you make your chances on an outlier higher. Okay. Another interesting falling knife. This Hemato was a falling knife, but another one is Lion Rock Group. And that's ticker 1127 in Hong Kong. And this is basically a printing company with a good earnings quality and also shareholder friendly. There's a famous investor in the stock, and that's David Webb. He owns a large stake, I think 13%. And David Webb is a well-known value investor from Hong Kong, and he specializes in companies with good governance, and cheap companies with good governance and good earnings quality. So that's remarkable that the such a stock is in the top of my list. Another great net is Italian company Isagro. The ticker is ISG, and it trades in Milan. And this company produces biological molecules for use in agriculture. And there are some debts, but the company has also sold an important asset. And I'm pretty sure this transaction completes. It sells it to a big American large cap company. When it completes, I think beginning of October, end of September, the stock trades below liquidation value. So this is a great example of a net that can go up much. I like net that have spent a lot on research and development during the last 5 years. This is one of them. Other net. Like that are biotechs, failed biotechs. So a biotech does a trial, it fails, stock crashes, and well, then if it's cheap enough, if the discount liquidation value is good enough, then it's often a good stock. Another net in a beaten down sector, and also a nano cap, is Bolevan. The ticker is BLVN in London. And they invest in an oil project somewhere in Africa. I think it was offshore in Cameroon. And they have plenty of cash. And normally they would receive a big milestone payment at the end of this year. But that depends on this project. And with this oil situation, I suppose it will be delayed. Mm-hmm. But we'll see. Another similar oil net is Entech Upstream, and the ticker is NTQ in London. And it's not really similar. It supplies drilling equipment for fracking in the US.
Okay.
So that doesn't sound very promising. But this equipment can also be used for drilling conventional oil projects. And it's trying to sell its equipment to countries like Russia, Saudi Arabia, and so on. And I like it also. It seems to have some intellectual property. I don't know how much. I've before this interview, I looked up how much they spent during the last 5 years, but I couldn't find it in my my screener. But I think that they mention it in their annual report, I think. Last one, a good nano cup. It might be Shinto Co. And that's totally different. There's no growth story, nothing. The ticker symbol is 5380 in Japan. And this company, guess what? It manufactures roof tiles from clay. So good old-fashioned roof tiles, I suppose. And it's extremely cheap based on price book. However, it's not so profitable. But until a couple of years, it was very profitable. So who knows? Will the good times come back ever? With a price book of 0.2 or so,
you don't need a lot.
You don't need a lot. You just need a double or so, right, of the profit. But right now it's kind of break even. So these are six examples. I have a couple of more, but for these strategies I focus on.
So what I want to ask is, what's interesting to me is you just presented six stocks, and I've looked at your service before, and I know you, and you shared something before. Mm-hmm. You have Excel sheets with hundreds, if not thousands, of stocks on quantitative rankings. What I'm curious is, and seven different strategies, as we mentioned, what does that mean for how you run your portfolio? Are you sort of said statistically that if you give yourself enough chances, these will work out. So I guess the question is, how wide a portfolio do you normally run? And in these cases, you know, you shared us six different names, you shared us some mm-hmm. information, but are you normally, how much research do you have to do before a stock enters your portfolio? Is it just a sanity check so that they're not criminals, like you said, or how does that work for you?
Yeah. Well, I research, first of all, I have so many stocks in these spreadsheets, I cannot research them all, but mm-hmm. I research many. And it adds up. I'm doing this already 5 years, so 20 stocks per month, even a bit more sometimes. If I can always find something, or not always, but very often, I can find something I have written before on the stock in with a good ranking in the list. How much time it costs? It depends. It depends on what has happened with this company. Sometimes this Japanese stock in clay roof tiles, that was an easy one. But then this Italian stock was more difficult. I had to keep track of the transactions and so on. But in general, I do whatever it takes to make a good business description. I look at related party transactions, who owns the stock. I look at the balance sheet, whether the stock is distressed. I look at discounts to liquidation value, that kind of stuff. And if I'm lucky, it takes 3 hours for one, right? For the Japanese stock, maybe 2.5 or 2 hours. So,
for the
but sometimes, yeah, if there's sometimes annual report is difficult to find, cannot be translated in Google Translate and so on, then it takes much longer. It can take more than a day. Yeah.
Taking the Italian stock in Sergio was the ISG.
Yeah.
That was interesting to me because you said that it will be below liquidation value after its transaction completes. So how does that pop up in the first place? Is it already a net, or it's already sort of close to that level, and so it's on your list, and then you do the work and you see, oh, and there's also a transaction that's going to actually pull it even more, or because that seems more than just the quantitative, right?
Yeah. That's a great question, and it showed as a net, but many net with a great ranking in my list, they are not really net. Often there is a subsequent event like a dividend, large dividend payment, and so on. So I see this. I think you cannot really take my list and invest in these stocks just quantitatively. You always need to exclude stocks that are not really net. And with the other strategies, that is much less so. But this stock showed up as a net. Then I looked, and then my conclusion was it was not a net. And then I think what happened recently and so on. And then I found this transaction. And then I thought, so what have they sold? Well, it took some more digging, and my conclusion was they've sold mostly intangible assets, and also they make a very nice profit on this. I think they sell these assets for 50 million and they book a profit of 20 million or so. So that adds up to the balance sheet. So then I make kind of a balance sheet including this transaction, and then I do the rest of the work.
Got it. Okay. So this was quite
a complicated thing to research. Well, one of the more difficult ones.
Right. Very, very interesting, though. I mean, yeah. I guess it's. I mean, it's still a classic screener approach, right? You screen. You have standards, and then you look further. Yeah, it's just interesting how that played out. Another strategy we talked about when we were emailing that I thought was interesting and I wanted to just ask real quickly was the idea you said you like expected high volatility stocks because the expected high volatility, as I understood, ultimately means that the market is building in a bigger discount, but not actual high volatility stocks. So I guess I was looking if you could elaborate a little more on any example of something like this.
Yeah, I don't like volatile stocks. I think they might perform as good as other stocks, but they are more risky. So for every stock, I compute the for every stock I look into, I compute the 3 years volatility based on stock prices in US dollars. So I get many stock prices in many currencies. I convert them to US dollars, all these stock prices, and I compute volatilities. And then I think the highest numbers should be avoided. But then in December, I keep reading research. And in December 2019, I finished a free book, free PDF from very good researchers about the concept popularity in investing. And in one of the chapters, it said that stocks investors expect they will go down more than the market. Those stocks are often underpriced. They have higher returns than other stocks. So that was a great insight for me. And so that's what I'm also using. It doesn't need to be true always, but it's just one way. And in this market, yeah, we have the beaten down sectors, of course. For instance, this Bolevin net and also large cap Lukoil. This is a Russian oil and exploration company with assets in Russia and also other countries. I think they are also in the project with Bolevin. And their large asset is in Iraq. Surprisingly, I haven't found many cheap tourism stocks. That's also a beaten down sector. I thought about it. Why not? Well, I'm looking for cheap stocks, either based on earnings or based on price book, without financial distress. And the problem with tourism stocks, maybe they are usually financially distressed. They have too much debt. When I think about the situation here in Amsterdam, for a long time, tourism was seen as a steady growth business that basically could not fail. In Amsterdam, number of tourists increases every year, until now, of course. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't be surprised if many hotel businesses, for instance, and airlines have leveraged up too much because they thought that it was they couldn't fail. And but I have found two interesting stocks. That one is Dolphin Capital, ticker DCI in London. And this company owns tourist resorts, but wants to update. It's in runoff mode. And there are some governance issues, I think, or at least things, payments to management of a size that I don't like. And the consolidated balance sheet looks strong, but there may be some financial distress in one of the subsidiaries. And more risky is Asiana Properties, I think. That is ticker ASPL in London. And by the way, this stock is low volatile stock, but I consider it still as more risky. And this company invests in property in Malaysia and Vietnam. They own a mall, shopping mall, two hotels, apartments, and a hospital. So there is some direct exposure to tourism and a lot of indirect exposure. And this company is in divestment mode, which I like. And unfortunately, it has a lot of debt on its balance sheet, And I didn't recommend it to my subscribers. And after discussing it in my newsletter, it went down with another 20 to 25%. And the company also announced a related party transaction that may be either troublesome or just fantastic. And there's another example of this principle. And I failed there. For years, I have been looking at many extremely cheap Japanese construction stocks. And I don't think I have ever invested in one of them, but I should have, I think, if I had known this principle. And that's a pity. The idea is also with these stocks that there was a lot of demand for construction because of the Olympic Games. And what you see after Olympic Games in many countries, that the economy, you get a recession. Yeah, so that was my fear. But it's, of course, stupid.
But when you say this principle, what do you mean by that? If you had known this principle, you're talking about the Olympic effect or something? I'm sorry, I may have missed what you're referring to.
This principle of that people avoid stocks that go down more than the market.
Okay, yeah. Got it. Okay. When you said the related party transaction that was either troublesome or fantastic, what do you mean? What's going on there?
Yeah, with Asiana Properties. I didn't look into it in much detail, but they want to sell some of the assets to the majority shareholder, and the majority shareholder it pays in shares, mm-hmm. So it basically exits, I think. Can be great, can be troublesome. We don't know.
Right, I see. Yeah, that is interesting. Okay. Yeah. So I think the tourism sector is an interesting one because I invest in a lot of travel-related stocks. Mm-hmm. I suspect it's split between high asset but highly levered stocks, which you mentioned hotels, airlines, cruise lines, on the one hand, or asset-light, service-oriented stocks that probably don't trade cheaply to book value because they don't have a high tangible book value. So that may be part of the issue.
Well, if they, or the latter category, if those stocks have high earnings, backward looking, then they could be great.
Right. Yeah. But of course, the market. I made this point on Twitter. It seems like the market is pricing in a lot of positive outcomes in a lot of different seemingly contradictory areas.
Right.
Travel highlights this.
I think so too. Yeah, at the moment still, but maybe not in a couple of months.
So that's a last question for you then, is you look at stocks around the world. Even though I live in Europe, I focus on the US market, and so I have more mind share about, okay, the US market to me seems like it's priced in a lot, but where are you seeing any markets that specifically stand out as offering a lot of value, or is it, how do you see the differentiation across different countries, different markets in the world?
I think that that the stocks in Hong Kong, net and low enterprise value divided by earnings before interest and tax, those stocks, they might be the cheapest stocks globally. It's from China, there is a continuous flow of bad news, and investors in these stocks, they have suffered from governance issues for many years. And in 2017, David Webb, he published a great blog article on the so-called Enigma network. He called them 50 companies not to own. And since then, I think governance has improved somewhat. It's not great at all still, but we see that the regulator even started handing out fines again and is criticizing certain certain companies, certain boards. I think one needs to be careful, still very careful, but future returns are worth the effort of investigating the stocks. And examples of quality stocks over there, I think they are Sager Chemical Group, ticker 1986. And again, Lion Rock Group, I've already mentioned it. Mm. And there is also Hua Bao International Holdings, ticker 336. So 336. And they have good, they seem to have good capital allocation and good earnings quality. This Hua Bao stock, they have a past with hit pieces and so on, with a lot of discussions, and there are some governance issues, I think, still over there. And another interesting market is Poland. Poland has one of these governments that I think in the long run that kind of governments are not good for the economy. But at the moment, there are many cheap Polish stocks, and in general, governance is very good in Poland. But again, one needs to be careful. I translate the filings in Google Translate, and they supply a lot of information, also small companies, which is good. I think still it's best to avoid those Polish stocks with even minor issues. But a lot of companies are absolutely clean, maybe not great businesses, but cheap. And I looked into three recently, and Patentus, ticker symbol PAT. What did they do? They produce mining equipment, and they've only two customers, but they are cheap.
Key customer risk.
Coal mines, right? So not so good business. And there is APS Energia, ticker APE. They supply power units, power conversion, power supply units. I think for maybe half of their revenue is from Russia. And there is Monari Trade, ticker MON. And that's a women apparel company.
It's quite a variety for the Poland market.
As anywhere.
Yeah, of course. That's and obviously Hong Kong right now. If you think of all those, be greedy when others are fearful. Mm-hmm. I would think Hong Kong this week, especially with all the news, is probably opening up a lot of fear in that market.
Yeah, surprisingly, I saw the Hong Kong dollar trading at its strongest point of its band with the US dollar. There's a peg, the peg is between 70.75 and 70.85 Hong Kong dollars for a US dollar. And right now it's more like 70.75.
Oh, interesting. And that's what, to go back to the expected high volatility, it's what's fascinating about the market is that it's not just fundamentals, it's also then what do people think will happen, and so that can be that George Soros reflexivity, and that mm-hmm. can end up causing a lot of effects that shouldn't happen but that do and then end up mm-hmm. bearing out.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. So.
Okay, great. This has been a lot of fun. I've been talking to Ruud Heeg, who writes Global Deep Value Stocks on Seeking Alpha. You can find his work there or on the Seeking Alpha Marketplace. Ruud, before we wrap up, any positions in any of the stocks you mentioned?
Yeah, my portfolio is now very small because I anticipate further downturn of the market, so I have no positions.
Okay, fair enough. Okay, but those, it's quite an interesting shopping list. Hopefully yeah. people can find something to investigate. Yeah. So, okay, great. Ruud, thank you so much. All the best to you with your investing, and hope yeah. that you stay safe out there. And thank you for taking your time this morning.
Yeah, thank you. Bye-bye.